Well, let's now turn to our attention to how this affects Nigerians in putting it into perspective. And to talk on this, I have with me via Skype an economist from the United States of America, Okechukwu Anyamale. I'm also being joined here by financial analyst here in Nigeria, Nnaemeka Obiaraeri. Thank you for your time, gentlemen.
Thank you for having me.
Yes, now let me start with from the United States now, that Okechukwu Anyamale. Now, what's the necessity of this immigration policy at this time, if you would assess it?
Well, the main purpose for the executive order, as it was outlined, is to help protect Americans. That is the main objective. But others have weighed in that rather than protect Americans, this might actually go against the fight against terrorism, in the sense that the cooperation that America receives from most of these countries will no longer be there. And terrorism is not an individual, it's not an isolated fight. You need cooperation from all governments, all countries, in order to fight terrorism. We know it crosses borders, and it's not something that one nation can actually fight alone. And there might be other implications also that will result from this. We're yet to fully assess this executive order. And the executive order itself is so vague that those who are supposed to enforce the orders are confused. And I believe that is one of the reasons why, thanks to the civil liberty groups, as well as some cities who have actually asked for a restraining order from the courts in order to enforce, to make sure that the rights of citizens from various parts of the world are protected.
Indeed. Now let me come to Nnaemeka Obiaraeri now. Nnaemeka, if you can hear me clearly, I'm looking at trade ties now, Nigeria and America. They've been foremost partners that, if you're looking at from this part of the world, that's doing business when it comes to business relations. Now, how do you think this immigration law or other policies by this new administration will affect these trade relations?
Okay. I think if you look at the relationship between Nigeria and U.S. is the one that has been so beneficial to us. If you look at the trade history, especially trade history between Nigeria over the last and the U.S. over the last 4 years, for example, if you look at 2012, we had a trade surplus over the U.S. That was at a time when they were still buying our crude oil. In that particular year, 2012, we had over $13 billion trade surplus because they imported most of our mineral, our crude oil. In 2013, it came down a little bit. We are still having a surplus of $5 billion. But from 2012, it thinned out when they started looking elsewhere to buy petroleum products. In that particular year, we suffered a trade deficit of about $2.1 billion. In 2015, it was still a deficit of $1.5 billion. And you recall again that in 2014, we had foreign direct investment from the U.S. of about $5 billion. In 2015, it was $5.2 billion. You know, for 2015, it thinned out because most of the investors from the U.S., because of the absence of clear-cut policy direction on the part of the economic management team, they've zeroed in and they've not been coming the way they used to come. And if you look at it again, if you look at, you know, we have to be proactive. We have to reject the ways of doing things. You look at one of the impact of the executive action signed by Donald Trump, you will discover that U.S. used to give Nigerians, allow us to do what we call Dropbox. For somebody that have gone to the U.S. before, has gotten visa before, for the second time, they will allow you to do Dropbox and they can give you 2 years visa. Now, look at it. From the point of view, the average American, we have partners from the U.S. who comes to Nigeria. To get Nigerian visa from the U.S. or from any of our embassies outside is very, very difficult. Do you know that it costs almost three times what it costs an average Nigerian to get the U.S. visa? Is almost three times. What it costs an average American to get Nigerian visa is three times what it costs the average Nigerian to get the U.S. visa. So this executive action by Donald Trump calls for us here in Nigeria, it's not just at our embassies and foreign offices to do a rejig. We should try and see, you know, one of the problems we have in Nigeria is that Nigerian force are the lower rung of countries that have ease of doing business. It's always difficult to do business in Nigeria. Accessing our embassies, even Nigerians in diaspora, to get Nigerian passport is so difficult. They make it so cumbersome. Some of the countries that have attracted most of the FDIs, the world is a global village. The resources are very, very scarce. But the needs of finances are so limitless. So capital migrate to those areas that have ease of doing business. So it calls for us to look inward to see what can we do to make it easy for people, especially those that have business in Nigeria, those that want to bring investment, to be able to come into Nigeria. I find it difficult understanding why a country that mounts, you know, the desire to attract investment into this economy, why it is difficult for our embassies, for our foreign missions to give access, to make it easy for foreigners who are willing to come here and invest to get the visa. I don't know why the cost of getting Nigerian visa should be more expensive than the cost of getting American visa. And we look at the
indeed, Nnaemeka, I'm going to come back to you now. I have to talk to Okechukwu Anyamele. Now, Okechukwu, in all of these policies now, even building the wall and the Mexicans will have to pay and all of that, some people are arguing that maybe President Trump still has to learn on some political maybe experience and all of that, and maybe all of this might not be put into play. When you consider that there are some policies in place that needs to be followed and you can't just upturn some of this things. Now, are you saying everybody is at peace or at ease with some of these new policies over there?
Not at all. That is, in fact, majority of the people are not happy with the policies, but you also have to understand that when people campaign for offices, they make promises or they espouse policies that they will pursue. And once they win election, they go on and pursue those policies. Now, some of these policies, even if they are not going to work, or they know that it's not going to work, that they will be challenged in court, have to be carried out by the candidate, now president, because those are policies that they made. That he made when he was running for office. So he has to redeem those promises. That is part of the what is going on. But I'm quite sure that at some point, both the legislative and the Congress will weigh in on some of these policies. Mexico has already said they're not going to pay for it. Of course, Mexico won't pay for it. Even if you have, Mexico is the second largest trading partner with the United States, Canada being number one. So U.S., as vast and big as it is economically, will feel some pain if Mexico were to break away. So it cuts both ways. I can understand the gentleman talking about foreign direct investment. Yeah, we need to look inwards. What he said to a large extent is true. Our own policies do not encourage businesses to come into Nigeria or people to invest in Nigeria. In fact, apart from those who live outside Nigeria that send remittances to Nigeria, the foreign direct investment to Nigeria it was very good last four or five years, but for the last 2 or 3 years, it has gone down drastically. So we need to perhaps rethink our policies in Nigeria. But that's an economic discussion for another day. How do we get foreign direct investment into not just Nigeria, into the sub-Saharan Africa as a whole? Because it is lacking compared with other countries. That have similar status.
Okay, I'll come back to Okechukwu now. Nnaemeka, I want to ask you, what role do you think Nigerians can play in actually, you know, to help address this challenge, maybe helping in reshaping some of these policies if they really are, they know that it's going to affect them negatively. I'm more concerned about trade, you know, agriculture, financial services. There are lots that we need. And you've also mentioned foreign direct investment. What role do you think Nigerians can play in all of this?
To strengthen activities at our foreign office and embassies, it's quite a huge joke and ridiculous that for a Nigerian passport holder to get an American visa, you pay about $160 to process it. But for an American passport holder to get Nigerian visa, you spend almost about $300. It's quite a huge joke that it costs almost twice for an American passport holder to get Nigerian visa, more than what it costs an average Nigerian passport holder to get American visa. Quite a huge joke. Why do I say it's a huge joke? The only thing that we export to America so far, based on, in 2014, Americans brought $5 billion worth of foreign direct investment. In 2013, $5 billion. In 2014, it was $5.2 billion. So basically, we are the ones that require investment from America. And what do we do? You know, this issue of issuing one-year visa to Americans or to foreigners coming to Nigeria should be revisited. We should try and reciprocate. The Americans issue us two-year visa, five-year visa, 10-year visa. Our embassies must also reciprocate it. The principle of reciprocity, increase their visa issuance about 2 years, and we should reduce the fees. And sometimes it takes longer period of time for these visas. See, most of our foreign partners who come into Nigeria, from the UK, from Britain, from America, from other places, they complain of the kind of stress they go through trying to get this. These are investors. These are people that will come into Nigeria to invest in our economy. So we must reduce our ways of doing this. Nigeria is a frontier market economy. We are an emerging market economy. Nigeria requires over $3 trillion in foreign in both local and foreign investment to be able to bridge our infrastructure gap, to bring it to the level of the second world country over the next 30 years. $3 trillion cannot easily be raised through fiscal revenue. Therefore, we must make it very, very easy for investors to come into Nigeria. The ease of doing business. Nigeria should be able to rank among the top 20 economies of the world for ease of doing business, if we stand a chance of attracting investment into Nigeria. And again, the issue of Boko Haram, the issue of Fulani herdsmen, these are issues, security issues that the average foreigner get to read about from the social media, from the mainstream media, about this country. Even the issue of militancy in the Niger Delta. Our political leaders do not saddled with the responsibility of fashioning policies and providing security for Nigerians must take painstaking structural, constitutional, sustainable measures to make sure that some of these are fixed. The situation where we have the Fulani terrorist herdsmen, after destroying villages, burning houses, our president and those who should know better will not issue any condemnation weeks and days after, should be poo-pooed even to the highest level. We must be proactive. We must painstakingly, concretely find ways of providing security. One of the things that attracts investment into an economy is stability of such economy, issues of security, and issues of making the means of doing business very, very easy. I think we can do it. If only our leaders, and even the led, if we can be honest to ourselves, do the right things, follow the right steps, but there should be reforms, total reforms at our embassies. I can tell you this, sometimes even to get the Nigerian passport in Nigeria from foreign embassies are so difficult. They make it so strenuous. Of course, you know why? Because they want to extort. Even at the immigration point, I have had situations where sometimes on my way back to Nigeria, there's no light. Everywhere is in darkness. Very
stuffy. Yes, yes, yes. Nnaemeka, I hear you there. Security and ease of doing business, very important, particularly to attract foreign direct investment. But we have to go on this break now, at a very short break, and we'll be back with more on the show. I'll still have Nnaemeka and Okechukwu online there now to speak more on this issue, particularly as regards the United States and indeed the world in general.